work of God. Only God can change our hearts. Only God can take a stony heart and change it to what it needs to be. I think that in my childhood, in my limited understanding, I thought that whenever you would get saved, the person would come forward and they place their trust in Christ, they filled out a decision card, and not long after that they were baptized. I thought there would be immediate change in their life. I thought that, man, it would be like pixie dust. Immediately, they would always be responding spiritually, always being kind, always being lovely. But I found out that wasn't always so. You know, I think that there's probably something that does happen in our lives, and I do know this, whenever you come to know the Lord as your personal Savior, you do know the burden of sin falls from you. It is a powerful thing. And whenever she was talking about the gospel not being shackled, as a believer, we're not shackled by sin. And that's very important for us to recognize. Now, let me tell you something. There has been a powerful, easy believism in our country today that's been going on for some time. And it is this. I want you to say this prayer after me. And if you'll say this prayer after me, if you'll do this, you'll go to heaven. And it's very important that we recognize it's not just about saying a prayer. You know, as well as, you know, have you ever heard anybody say, well, if you'll just repeat this prayer after me, Jesus will come into your heart? Okay? Nowhere in the Scripture does it say that Jesus will come into your heart. That's just what we have done to try to make it more understandable to people. But it's not there. What it is this. Jesus, the Lord Jesus Christ, wants to come and make His permanent dwelling place within you. And whenever He makes that permanent dwelling place within you, as you abide in Him, the Scripture tells us in Psalm 91 and 92 that He is our refuge, He is our comforter, He is our strength. And He wants us to abide in Him, and He wants to abide in us. Now, how does that happen? Do you think that if you went out of here today, and every person that you saw, that you went up to and said, can I ask you a very important question? Do you know if you were to die today, where you would spend eternity? Do you think you'd get based on who we are in the South, you might get a different response from different people. Many people may say to you, well, I made a profession of faith whenever I was whatever. I went forward and I made a profession of faith. I said a prayer. Let's just even talk about the Billy Graham Crusade. I watched the Billy Graham Crusade, and I said a prayer, and I asked Jesus to come into my life. And undoubtedly, many thousands, maybe millions of people have done that. And what a great testimony that is if they by faith believed, right? But if all they did was put their faith in just saying a prayer, because anybody here want to go to hell? Please raise your hand. Anybody ready to go to hell? So I'm sure if we did that today and we went all over the country and we said, how many of you would like to go to hell? We're getting together a bunch of people that would like to go to hell. Because of the situation that we find ourselves in our country today, I am sure that there would be some people that would say, yes, let's go, we're going to have a party. But I would say the vast majority of people would say, I don't want to go to hell. What can I do to keep from going to hell? So salvation to them was more like getting my car. I've got to get my free pass. I've got to get the certificate. I need something tangible that I can hold on to. I said a prayer. I filled out the card. They dumped me in the tank. I am now a believer. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe He died. I said a prayer. Okay? Now let me ask y'all something. If I did all of that and I said that, does that make me a believer? You're pondering. No, it doesn't. Because even the devil knows how to save you. The devil knows the Scripture. The devil believes in God, the Bible says, and trembles. Now, there is a reverential fear that we should have, and I will tell you, last Wednesday night, we had a really good time with our men's group for our Bible study on the fear of God, the fear of men. And the women had a really good time because they got hung up in there for a while. I don't know what they were doing, but I think they were having a good time in the Scriptures and a prayer time. If you're able to join us on Wednesday nights, come at 6:30. It's very informal. If you got to bring a biscuit and sit down with us, you can do that. But come and be encouraged and fed on Wednesday nights at 6:30. And I think it'll prove to encourage you in your growth with the Lord. But what I want to tell you is this. It is not about filling out a card. It's not about getting a certificate. It's not about being baptized as a baby. None of those things secure me a home in heaven. Not any of those things. It is about the relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. It is about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And it is understanding that God Himself had to become man for Him to experience this sinful world, and for Him to be the perfect Son of God, not having any sin, and being willing to die to pay the ransom for us. And whenever He was hung upon that cross, and He says, "Father, do not forsake me." Whenever God turned His back on His only begotten Son, it's because of the weight of the whole world and the sinfulness that came upon Him, because He took on Himself all of our sin. And whenever He did that, the Scriptures tell us, and with His stripes we are healed. Whenever we come to that place, whenever we recognize that Jesus Christ paid the full payment and penalty, took the penalty for our sin, He did that on the cross. Now, there's much that has to happen. I think we have to realize as believers, there's a whole lot of people that claim to be Christians, but they walk around like the world, and it's kind of confusing. We deal with some things in school periodically because we have kids that are, you know, they're trying to be what we as adults want them to be. Y'all ever know that? And then they're being what they want to be whenever no adults are around. And it's kind of like whenever people are around other believers, you can talk the talk of believers, but then whenever you're around the world, you can talk the talk of the world. These things should not be, brethren. And so there should be a separation in the world. And so whenever I'm looking at this and I'm thinking about these things, I just want to challenge you. I'm going to do it again. There we go. I just want to challenge you, because whenever I was pondering on this and I was thinking about the life of Billy Graham, and I was thinking about our responsibility of as believers, I think it's really important for us to get a hold of the understanding that it is not any work that we do that brings us to the place of full repentance in Jesus Christ. There's not any work that we can do to gain entrance into heaven. And as I was thinking on this, and as I was also going over what we're doing in our catechism, I was pointed to this passage of Scripture, and so I'd like for you to turn there, Ezekiel 36. Ezekiel 36. And if we can start reading in Ezekiel 36, I would like for us to read verse 26 and 27. Verse 26 and verse 27, it says, "A new heart will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart of your flesh, and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall heed my ordinances and do them." The Amplified Bible says, "A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh." I will give you a heart of flesh. And then it says, "And I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes." My statutes are the Word of God. "And you shall keep my judgments and do them." Well, as you look at this, whenever someone comes to know Christ as their Lord and Savior, they are not immediately made perfect. There will be Christians that will fail, right? They're not made perfect. The difference in this is this. You must realize this. If you run into a carnal Christian that is always a carnal Christian, then most likely they're carnal and not a Christian. Did y'all hear me? If they are continually sinning and choosing to stay there, then the Scripture is very clear about that. They probably are not His. If I choose to sin and stay in sin, and I experience no discipline or punishing hand of God in my life to get me where I need to be, if I have no conviction of sin, there it is. If I have no conviction of sin, then I want you to know something. I am not His child. If I can sin, sin, and I can continue to do that, and I have no retribution, I have no sense or awareness of my actions sending people the wrong direction, or me hurting the cause of Christ, or me seeing, recognizing, wait a second, this is not pleasing my Heavenly Father. If I don't recognize that at all, I want you to understand something. I most likely am not a believer. What I have done is I have said a prayer. I've gone through the traditions of men. I have made sure I filled out the card, and I made a decision. My faith is in a decision. I want you to understand as well today, because as we look at this, and I wish our church house was packed today, but I understand things like that happen. God has new needs to be here today, so I want your focus, if you'll just listen very intently to what I'm saying. Because I would tell you that in our country today, people say 65 to 75% say that they are believers. Okay? Whenever you run into that 65 or 75% of those that are in church today, if their faith and trust is in a decision that they made, because I made a decision whenever I was 12, because I made a decision whenever I was 16, or I made a decision when I was 5, I made a decision when I was 32. I want you to understand something. If they have not come to the place of a personal love relationship with God, if they have not experienced the mercy and grace of God, all they did was make a decision. And we have become our country has become very consumed with getting decisions, but not really helping people grow in the grace and knowledge of their Lord and Savior. And so as I pondered on this, I want to just give you a couple things from this passage of Scripture, and things that really God hold in my own heart. And I just wanted you to see this, because I believe that whenever we're looking at this today, whenever we have to deal with ourselves, dealing with me is a big enough task. You know, I don't have time to poke out all the problems with other people. I have to deal with myself daily. Making sure that I'm staying focused on the Word of God is very important to me. Whenever I got up this morning, praying. Whenever I go to bed tonight, praying. Whenever I, throughout the day, praying. Because I want to keep my focus and my love relationship with Christ right. Y'all know. But it's a challenge, right? Things can get you totally off guard. People can get you totally wound up. It's amazing the things that can happen. And we can let people take our joy away very quickly. Just the littlest things. As we've gone through this process of getting our house put back together, you know, we can be happy for about 5 minutes, and then my word, something, you know, well, did we tell you that this is what's wrong, or did we tell you there's something else, or did we tell you that you're not going to get your check for another 4 to 6 business days? And, you know, there can be just one thing after the other. Have you gone through anything this week that you went through that someone actually, by words that they said, caused you to have that moment, and it just, you're going, you know, and your first response is, I talked to a lady on the phone this week. She knows me by name at my mortgage company, and I know her well, and I have been having to go through this process to get funds released so we can get our house back together. And I always just love it whenever it comes on this recording. It says, we are so concerned for people that have gone through this recent hurricane. Well, the recent was in September, right? And we want to help you get your lives back together. Every time I hear that, I want to throw the phone through the wall. Now, that is, you know, that is not Christ-like. Okay? If I can be angry and sin not. Now, there's the Christ-like part, right? And I have really been letting the Lord do that in me. It is not an easy place to be. Because you can get angry, but do you take it to the next step? You know, every one of us have to battle it. Some of us have to battle it more than others, right? And, you know, there are some people that have an immense immediate blow-up. And then there's others that have a steady, like, slow burn. And whenever that steady, slow burn finally gets to where, you know it's coming, right? You know it's coming. And it may be days. And boy, whenever it finally hits, the blow-up has happened. And everything all the way back from 1922 is brought up. You know? And by the way, that's not forgiving Caesar, is it? I just needed to vent. Somebody put on Facebook the other day. I just needed to vent, and I was going, no, you don't need to vent. I know what you're saying, and I know that you think that it'll make you feel better, but it's not about venting. It's going to hurt your testimony. But you know, people in the world today think they have a right to vent. I'm going to tell you, the best way for you to vent is go to your Heavenly Father.
Yeah.
And we have a little room upstairs on, I guess it's on the third floor, and we are striving to make that our area that we can just go for prayer and focus on those things and keep the Lord focused and centered in our life. And, with all this that has been going on, I've been going downstairs to the basement, and then I've been turned all over the place, but I thought, well, you know, I can pray anywhere, right? And I can go anywhere, and I can have my fellowship with the Lord anywhere. And it's really important that whenever we go through whatever the circumstances may be, that we just keep our focus on Christ and Christ's likeness. So whenever I was talking to this woman, who I was challenged with again, the continual ministry of the Holy Spirit was there, be Christ-like, be Christ-like, be Christ-like. Long-suffering. Do you like to be long-suffering? No. Whenever somebody comes to return something at Walmart and they don't have a receipt, and then, you know, they look all through this thing and they say, no, that's not even our product. People get all wound up and they want their money and they want it now. I'll never forget the time whenever I was in the ham business and we actually had a man come from our competitor, brought the ham in and slammed it on the counter and said he wanted his money back. And we told him that it wasn't our product, but we'd be happy to give him a good one. You know, he had made a total, terrible scene in front of everyone. And yet, you know, he had no remorse whatsoever. He cussed just as much going out the door with a new ham that we gave him free. Because he couldn't see himself. Have you ever run into that? So let me ask you, whenever we think about this passage of Scripture, the only way that my stony heart can be changed is by the wonderful work of grace in my life. It is not anything that I can do. Right? Amen? So it's not anything that I can do. And I would submit to you, and some people may not really appreciate this, but I would submit to you that many people, if they have continued in church after they made a decision, I would submit to you that some people may not have gotten saved on the day that they thought they did. But it may have been later in their journey of faith where they really started to know Jesus Christ and God really did a work of grace in their life. Because so many times a decision was made that there was not still a full repentance and a full belief and faith and trust in Christ. And you have to come to the place where there is a full faith and trust and belief in Jesus Christ as the Son of God. For the only remittance of your sin, there's no other way. So, as we consider this in this passage of Scripture, I want us to just jot down a couple things that I hope will encourage you. The first thing is the character of the heart that has changed. You know, the character of our heart, whenever we're born, we are born, the Bible says, in sin. We have a deceitful heart, a wretched heart. The Bible says our heart is deceitful. Who can know it? I've heard people say, well, I think I know his heart. And I want to say, no, you're not God. You do not know another person's heart. You may see the way that they react. You may see the common situations in their life. But you don't know their heart. Only God knows their heart. So at birth, our hearts are deceitful. We're desperately wicked, the Bible says. We are separated from God. And there is no way that we can have our relationship restored to God except by recognizing the Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sin, shed his blood to pay the penalty for our sins. There is no other way. Now, we have to recognize that with this stoniness and with this defeated spirit, with where we come from, whenever we recognize who God is, Mom was talking about sending this exchange. If you have never gone through that study on the exchange, it's important to do that. I went through that with several people that's here. And as you go through it, you recognize the holiness of God, what the holiness of God demands. And it's important for us to reflect on that. Because God's holiness demands that we change. God's holiness. in one brokenness. Well, if we're really in the right love relationship with God, change can happen and brokenness can come, and faithfulness will be a byproduct of a love relationship with Him. So as we look at that, we have to recognize the character of our own heart. The Bible has a lot to say about the character of us, the center of us. And sometimes people really show their character. And as I said, if a person continues to dwell in sin and they have in no way feel conviction over that sin, I want you to know something. They are not His child. So the character of the heart changed. The heart can be changed, and it can be changed from a stony heart. And the Bible says right there in this passage, a new heart will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. And you shall heed my ordinances and do them. Whenever I am purposing to follow the statutes of the Lord, whenever I am purposing to walk in Christ, that is something that comes out of a love relationship and a deeper study and awareness of who He is and what He wants to perform in my life. We're living in a day and age in this generation where many young people are looking at all of the things that we have done in tradition, and they're just saying, why did we do that? Why is this? Why do we do this? Why? I had someone say to me, do you have visitation at 7 o'clock on Tuesday night? And I said, no, we have it 24/7, and we have it 7 days a week. And they said, how do you do that? And I said, it's about being a born-again Bible believer. Because we are supposed to be doing that everywhere we go, right? We are supposed to be giving people a reason for why we believe what we believe. We are supposed to be sharing the gospel of Christ every time we have the opportunity. Because we worship Him with our lives. Every choice we make is an act of worship. So the heart, the character of the heart changed. This heart of mine was changed. And I have been being changed as the Lord has changed me and grown me in my relationship to Him. The next thing that I see here is the capacity of the heart changed. How can this happen? The capacity, the heart's capacity. Only a changed heart has the capacity for divine joy. Only a changed heart has the capacity for divine joy. Look over in Psalm 16, would you, real quickly? Psalm 16, I want to give you some verses to ponder on. But Psalm 16, verse, I believe it's 17. Or verse 7. Yeah. I will bless the Lord who hath given me counsel. My reins instruct me in the night seasons. I've set the Lord always before me because He is at my right hand. I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad and my glory rejoices. My flesh also shall rest in hope. For Thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt Thou suffer Thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou wilt show me the path of life. In Thy presence is fullness of joy. At Thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Folks, I have fullness of joy because I have a relationship with Him who loved me and gave Himself for me. I have a continual, not just happiness, but fullness of joy. The relationship with Christ that grows within me. We are living in a day that can become so defeating. And if you look around, people can really, people can get you very discouraged. The hatefulness of people, it can be very alarming. But at the same time, whenever you work with younger people, I talked with someone the other day, and they said, it's so disappointing to see there are just no young people that are stepping up for Jesus Christ. And I said, well, I don't know where you're looking, but I know there are. And it's important for us to focus on what God wants to do and His ability to take hearts and change them to be what God wants them to be. But a changed heart has the capacity for divine joy. Divine joy only comes because of a relationship with God. Happiness is fleeting moments, but divine joy is eternal. So as we look at that, we have to reckon with what God can do through a changed heart. Our old heart cannot know the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit of God. Our old heart cannot know the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit of God. Have you learned to listen to the Holy Spirit in your life? Pastor, audible voice? No, I'm talking about the leadership of the Holy Spirit. whenever you get into the Word of God, or whenever you're in circumstances because you've been trusting Him through circumstances and you don't know what to do, then the Holy Spirit of God continually brings back passages of Scripture to your life. You know, lean not to your own understanding. I say that verse all the time, but it's the battle for every one of us. Because we do lean to our own understanding. So whenever I think about this, I think about the joy that He gives me. But a person that does not know the Lord Jesus, they might be religious, but they cannot have abiding joy. They cannot know the presence of the Holy Spirit of God. Please know this, folks. Please know this. It is not about how I feel on Sunday or whenever I'm done singing a song. It's not about a feeling. It's about an ongoing relationship with Christ. It's so sweet whenever you do get into the Word, or whenever you do sing songs and hymns, and whenever you meditate on the Lord, whenever you're driving down the road, and you're just having a time with the Lord. I come up beside people sometimes, and I knew they were just having a time. This one lady I drove up beside one time, and buddy, her whole heart was shaking, and she was just having a time, and I could tell she was just clapping her hands, and it's the longest stoplight, and I was just sitting there. She finally caught my eyes, and I rolled the window down, she brought her back. She said, just praise Jesus. And I said, well, you go, girl. You know, just don't let it get a hold of your foot, because you're going to fly through that light. But she was praising the Lord. Do you go every day praising Jesus? Do you recognize that He is with you, and He walks with you, and He talks with you, and He changes you, and He grows you as you conform? He wants you to be conformed and changed. We were singing about that. Holiness is what I long for. You know something? If we long for Christ more, and we long for heaven more, and we long to be what He's called us to be, the holiness will come, and the faithfulness will come, and the brokenness will come. But it's not something we naturally long for. It's something that we supernaturally long for. I supernaturally long for heaven, my home. Naturally, I just want to go home today, have something to eat, and take a nap. But supernaturally today, I am looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of my faith. Right? I can't do this. I couldn't get up here today. I couldn't come today. I had a terrible night last night. I couldn't hardly make myself get out of bed. Didn't want to come. Some other people come to anybody. But do you know, sir, have you been there? Sure. And do you know when you find out every time you make yourself and the Holy Spirit prods you and you follow through? Every time you're thankful that you did. And you're encouraged that you did. Because faithfulness is what the Holy Spirit longs for within you. Brokenness is what the Holy Spirit longs for within you. A continual cleansing of the Word of God and a dying to self. The heart of a changed person has the capacity to walk in joy and peace and long-suffering, kindness. You know, the old heart cannot know the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit of God. The old heart chains us down with our sin. The old heart closes us within. The old heart is bound to death, hell, and the grave. The old heart, the stubborn, stony heart that's easy for us to grasp up, easy for us to quote a verse, easy for us to just do what we think we ought to do on Sunday. The old heart can dress itself up, but the old heart is chained with sin. The new heart is opened up to God. The new heart is reaching out saying, Lord, I want a closer relationship with You. The new heart is saying, I want to understand this Word better. The new heart is wanting to learn more about Him. The new heart is growing in grace. The new heart is looking for opportunities to share His love to others. The new heart is saying, Bible study, I want to be there. The new heart is saying, I'll be faithful. I'll be true. You can count on me. I want to share the gospel. Help me know how I can do that. The new heart is saying, I'll take bread. I'll go do whatever I can do. I want to meet people. I want to be here for Hope for the Hungry. I want to share the gospel. grow their love relationship with Christ. The new heart. The old heart is chained by sin. But it can be changed. And it can be made clean. Psalm 73:1, if you'll look at Psalm 73, several verses here I want to just challenge you with for you to ponder on. Psalm 73. Truly, truly, God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. Clean heart. God is good, not just to Israel, but to us. How is our heart clean? God can take a stony heart and make it clean. Whenever God looks upon us, whenever we've accepted Christ, whenever God looks upon us, there's no other way that He can except through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And God makes us clean because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ and our faith and trust in Him. The grace of God does the work. So, whenever we look at this, the changed heart is clean in Psalm 73:1. The joyful heart. We see this joyful heart in God in 1 Samuel 21. We see an upright heart in Psalm 97:11. We see an obedient heart in Psalm 119, verse 112. We see a prayerful heart in 1 Samuel 1:13. We see a devoted heart to God in Psalm 9:1. See, whenever we really want God, whenever we really come to that place and we put our faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, there is a change that is continually taking place from the stony to the pliable. I want to be like You, Lord. I want You to change me, Lord. I want to tell somebody else about You today, Lord. I want You to conform me to Your image today, Lord. I want the Lord to continually be transforming me, right? So, there is the character of the heart changed, and then the heart's capacity to change. You see, the heart's control changed. Before I came to know the Lord as my personal Savior, my heart was directing my steps, and it was controlled by my selfish desires. Whenever you come to know Christ as your Lord and Savior, it's not about your selfish desires anymore. Supernaturally, the working of the Holy Spirit of God, he tells us don't grieve the Holy Spirit. So supernaturally, we are supposed to be yielding to the working power of the Holy Spirit. I find myself uncomfortable as a believer doing something that I know will grieve the Holy Spirit. Have you ever been there? Have you been in circumstances or places that you found yourself and you're going, no, this grieves the Holy Spirit. If you've never experienced that, folks, there's something wrong. Because there has to be a place when you recognize it is more than making a decision. It is more than filling out a card. It is more than just saying, I read those passages of Scripture. It's more than being baptized. It is about a personal love relationship with Jesus Christ. God so loved the world that He gave. And whenever He gave the opportunity for every man all over this globe. The Bible says it's not His will for any to... It's not His will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And what is so vital, what we've got to understand, yes, God knows who will accept Him. God knows who will reject Him. But it is still not His will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. There's the balance. God's sovereignty, man's responsibility. So it's not faith or confidence in our decision. Because our heart can be deceitful. I know personally that I did not set out to deceive anyone, but I was deceived myself. Have you ever seen yourself deceive yourself? Believer or even as an unbeliever. But as you can be deceived. You have to question your thinking sometimes. Why am I leaning this way? Why do I just think that's all right? If you have questions, if you are working and you have been puzzled on something for hours trying to determine whether or not you should do it, if you're a believer and you're really asking the Holy Spirit of God to show you, do you know something? You already know you probably shouldn't be doing it. But you're looking for the opportunity. You're looking for a way. It's like I said the other day. It's like a person that said to me, do I have to tithe on the gross or the net? Do you know something, folks? Tithing is an example. It's an example. And whenever you think about this, you've got to get a hold of it. There's the example of a tenth that was in farming. And then there was also that grain that was left out, you know, about Boaz and what happened there. So there's the example there. But think about how beautiful this is. God always gives, and God always meets your need, and He'll always, always, always give you what you need. He always provides. And so tithing is an example of the Old Testament, but you must understand this as well. What the reality is I can't outgive God. Try to outgive Him. Don't look for what I have. Well, let's see. Let me figure out 10% of it. Oh, 10%, my word, that's a lot of money. You know, you don't think about whenever you leave somebody a tip. Now, don't you love it whenever you get the receipt and it says on here 15%, 18%, 20%, 25%, and it tells you what it is that you can joyfully give? Because you should do that. I loved it when we went to Paris because they already billed that debt. You don't have to leave a tip. It's built in. They pay their employees a reasonable wage so they don't get a tip. I mean, unless they just did something exceptional. But they don't expect that. Do you know something? We ought to be so quick in our giving to give all that we can because God gave it all to us. We own nothing. He owns everything. So as we grow in Christ, God takes our stony heart and He makes it pliable and He makes us more sensitive to the wooing and the wonderful working of the power of God and the Holy Spirit of God. And I look for every area that I can give to Him because I want to receive blessing, not just the blessing of the Lord, but I want people to see God's handiwork in my life. I want everything I have to be a testimony of God's grace in my life. So you see the character of the heart changed and you see the capacity of this heart to change. You see how the heart's control is changed. We're so attached to this world. It's easy to be led by our selfish desires. The new heart is under new control. Controlled by Christ. It's controlled by the Holy Spirit. I have a different life. I have a different spirit. I have motivation. Why do I do what I do? Not because I want to please me. It's because I want to please Him. Every moment of my life, I'm striving to please Him. Every choice I make is an act of worship. Will you say that with me? Every choice I make is an act of worship. Say it again. Every choice I make is an act of worship. So if I really believe that, with all my heart, then whenever I make choices, I want them to be what most pleases God. It's not going to be about me ever. Every choice is an act of worship. So, rejoicing with joy unspeakable. Whenever I go over this, I'm going to tell you, there is so much that we can devour from this. These two little verses. But what really compelled me was the reality of knowing that I'm no longer held in bondage of sin and that the chains have been broken, that I don't have to choose. I don't have to choose. God gives me a choice. Let me say it that way. God gives me a choice to do what most pleases Him. He does not demand it, right? I can go ahead and do my own thing. And there are times whenever I'm not walking in Christ, and there are times whenever I'm not purposing to be led by Him, that I lean to my own understanding. And whenever I come back to this place, though, and I'm constantly reminded because of the rebuke of the Holy Spirit, was that something that I should have done? Was that something that I should have said? Whenever I'm looking at opportunities for ministry, whenever I'm looking for our message for today, whatever it may be, however I can implore someone to come to Christ, or as it's our young people in our school, to think about how can we help them, how can we get into their head? Only God can do a work of grace in their life. You know, it's the same when we deal with family members or people that we know and love, and we just so want to see them change, but we can't change them. The testimony that we will share with others so much to come as the life that we live before them. And as I started out talking about the life of a great evangelist, and it should not be exclusive to one man that was willing to give his life for others. 99 years old. How remarkable that he has children that are wanting to carry on the gospel of Jesus Christ. How remarkable that God is so using the simple presentation of the gospel. Because folks, we can get so caught up on things sometimes that are so distracting and so divisive that that's all that people see. They don't see what God wants to perform. I'm thankful for the day that I came to know the Lord as my personal Savior. I'm thankful that whenever He came into my life, He began a work of change within me. And that the Holy Spirit of God took full reign. And that daily, moment by moment, every choice that I make, I strive to please Him. It is only something that He is performing in me. I am growing to be what He wants me to be. I have not arrived. But do you know, whenever God looks at me, He looks at me standing complete in Him because of the finished work of Jesus Christ. I can do nothing to gain entrance into heaven because it's by grace that I have been saved. Where is your personal relationship with Christ? Are you growing in Christ? Are you becoming what He wants you to be? Or are you just doing what religious people do? I have a young man in our school that has made it clear that he is not saved. There are others that would say they're saved, but I would probably say I don't know that they are. So, but this young man has told me that he does not know the Lord. And he got up in Bible class the other day and he said, since coming to Maranatha, I am seeing more and more of the need of religion in my life. And I sat there and I thought, Lord, please help him learn that it's more than religion. And I'm going to continue to give him everything that he can give so that he'll see his need for Christ. Do y'all pray for our kids every day? Pray for our staff every day? Do you pray for people in our church every day? There's this list right here of people that have come through those doors that we've served and we've given food to. Some we may not ever get back. Some may use it for the moment. Remember the multitudes that followed Christ that took advantage all the time and got free meals? But He sat down and He shared the simple gospel with them. And He challenged them. And He showed them that they could not fulfill the law. And the only way that the law, if they could ever fulfill the law, was for them to recognize that they were dead in sin. And that there had to be a penalty and a payment for that sin. There had to be a sacrifice. And the only sacrifice for that sin was the Messiah, the Son of God, that would take away the sin of the world. When I think about the patience that Jesus just so gave to the disciples and the people around Him, you or I, if we had been Christ and had all of the power and the splendor of heaven, what we would have done, you know, in our lack of perfection. If I could just be that person for a little, have you ever thought, boy, if I was God? But if you were God, it'd be a whole different picture. You'd be a righteous judge. He is patient with us, isn't He? And He's mighty to save. He gives us opportunities to declare His glory. How are we doing? He speaks to us through the Word of God. He wants to change us, and He wants to take our stony heart and create in me a clean heart, the Bible says. And He can do that. But we have to yield, and we have to walk in obedience to Him. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. That's important, because the old things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. Are you in the process of all things becoming new? Or are you still walking